Hello, I'm Sam, and I'm back with another screencast about Swift 3. Today, I'm going to talk about the new API naming guidelines. As dull as this sounds, please don't switch off quite yet. Trust me, there's some good stuff in here. As you migrate your projects from Swift 2 to Swift 3, you'll notice that loads of the Cocoa and Cocoa Touch APIs have all changed names. In this screencast, I'm going to take a look at some of the justification behind that. In addition to that, it'll really help as you build up your own APIs in your own projects. There are three core tenets behind the naming conventions. The first is that you should strive for clarity at the point of use, i.e. where you call your methods and functions. Second is that you should tune your APIs as if it's a sensible person using them. And finally, you should omit needless words. These are all sufficiently abstract that they don't make any sense on their own. I'm going to take a look at a specific application of this in some code, demonstrating that you should use the type system to your advantage, and you should assume that the user of your code has named their variables sensibly. I've got an example here with an image request and an image loader. And what I want to do is create a method on the image loader that you pass an image request object to it. I'm going to call this function addRequest. It's going to take an image request. I'm not going to do anything because we're only talking about naming here. Now, if I were to go ahead and use that method, then I'd have loader.addRequest request request, which seems a little bit over the top. And this is precisely the point of this first guiding principle. Don't repeat yourself and don't repeat words dictated by types. You can assume that at the call point, you have named the object you're going to pass into it something useful. You assume that the user of your code is not an idiot, which if I'm using it isn't true. So I'm going to try again, but this time making it make a little bit more sense. So I'm going to start out with a video request struct and a video loader class. I'm going to create the method again. This time though, the method is going to be called add. I'm going to use the underscore there so we don't name that first parameter. We're going to put request in so that we can refer to it inside the function, and it takes a video request. Now I'm going to go ahead and create an instance of video request and an instance of the video loader. Now when I come to use the video loader's add method, I'll instead type video loader.add video request, which not only reads far more easily in English, but also gives you all of the information that you need. Since the type system allows you to have multiple different functions with the same signature, but using different types, then when should you do this? Well, the rule is you only overload a particular function or method if it is semantically the same as the one that you're overloading, i.e. it performs the same operation. So my video loader class is also going to have some way of outputting this value, and it's going to do that with a video output handler object. Now I'm going to put an extension on video loader. I'm going to call the function add. It's going to take an output handler, which is the type video output handler. I'm going to instantiate one of these video output handlers, and then I would type video loader add video output handler. The naming conventions suggest that you shouldn't overload the same method name unless it is semantically the same. So for example here, you should probably rename this addOutput, since it's doing something completely different to the add method. A large part of the naming conventions is based around the fact that your call sites make grammatic sense in English. You can be more specific than this by saying that methods and functions that have side effects should be named as if they are verbs, which makes sense, right? Verb is a doing word. If your function does something, it should be named as a verb. If your function or method returns something, then it should be named as a noun, the thing that you get back. Now this works quite nicely in value types as well as reference types. When you see mutating functions, they should be verbs, and if non-mutating functions should be nouns. In addition to this, there's various other core naming conventions that you should use when naming methods and properties on your types. I'm going to start out with a new type. I'm going to call it a word list struct. The first rule is to only use the first argument if you can't make a grammatical phrase without it. For example, here I want to create a method that will return a word from the word list at a given index. So here it would be word underscore at index. So if I instantiate one of these word lists and then go ahead to use it, then my call site would look like list.word12. Well, it doesn't make any sense. So in order to make grammatical sense, I'm going to name that first argument. Here, list word at 12 makes perfect sense. Next up, the rules for method naming. If a method has side effects, then name it with a verb. Whereas if it returns something, then you name it with a noun. So in this word list struct, if I have a mutating function, then that has side effects. So for example, sort alphabetically, then that needs to have a verb, hence sort alphabetically. Often in these value types, then you'll have a mutating version and a non-mutating version of the same thing, where the non-mutating version will return a new version of that value. In order to do that, you use the edIng rule. So here we turn sort alphabetically into sorted alphabetically, and that will return a new word list with the sorting done for you. So there you've replaced the sort with sorted to go from a verb to a noun. It's not always possible to use ed, in which case you should use ing. For example, if I have the mutating function remove words containing and then provide a substring, then this obviously mutates it, so therefore that should be a verb phrase, which it is. But then to turn that into the non-mutating version, then you can't use an ed form. Removed words containing doesn't make any sense. So in this case, you should use the ing form. So here we've got removing words containing, and that will provide you with a new word list. The final bit of guidance in terms of naming, and that comes down to Boolean properties. These should always start with the word is. So for example, is sorted alphabetically Boolean property here. There are, of course, more naming conventions than this, and I urge you to go and take a look at them. Naming is one of those weird things that takes on religious levels of arguments. I reckon if you understand and invoke these naming guidelines, you can probably not only understand Coco better, but reduce the number of those pointless religious arguments that we seem to have every day as a software developer. As ever, thanks for joining me on this screencast, and I hope you'll come back for some more Swift 3 iOS 10 screencasts in the near future. Cheerio.